We are working the rolling bicycle-based health fair display booth, and we're telling people that you can crowdsource mental illness, and basically you can use your friends and your own personal strengths to overcome adversities in your life. And we're gathering video and stories from other people about things that they do to build personal power in their lives.
And where are y'all going to display this or show this? Or?
We have a website, poetryforpersonalpower.com, and we post the videos and stories up there.
Okay.
In addition to collecting stories.
Right there on your bike.
Yeah, here it is. In addition to collecting stories, we're sponsoring open mic poetry contests with a cash award. Going to encourage people to try out one avenue of the arts to find personal power to overcome challenges. Because there's many different ways, using the arts, using friendship, different hobbies, and to find what you need to overcome any kind of issue you might be having.
Okay.
You can find that information on the website.
And tonight you're just gathering... doing a survey?
Yeah, we're gathering surveys and stories and videos from people that are out on the streets. And our grant's targeted towards young adults that are age 18 to 25. So we're finding people who are talking about recovery or how they've used their friends or how they've connected with the community to try to get through really tough times in their lives.
Okay. All right, is there anything else that you can answer?
Well, both of us are people who have experienced recovery from mental illness ourselves, and one of the ideas about people like us, we're part of what's called the consumer movement, and we're a civil rights movement of people that are working to make mental illness more accessible and so that people actually recover instead of staying sick the rest of their lives. And we both just want to spread the message that people can get better, and sometimes their problems can actually even go away. It's not a lifetime sentence.
Okay. People can recover, and also we want to be a full part of the community. Everybody can participate in the community just like everyone else and pursue things like employment and any other interest they might have in the community.
This is an exhibition I've curated that is titled A Glimpse Inward, and involves this idea of looking within. It includes autobiographical comic books, paintings, videos, and kinetic sculptures, and it really works to find a common thread between a handful of people I know and find a place where you can kind of dwell internally and think about internal structures, and it comes through in introspective ways, visual ways, and really kind of draws on the present and the past.
Okay, and who are the artists?
The artists are Roland Beamish, Caleb Taylor, Chris Turbuck, Lori Hyris, and John Douglas Powers.
And some of this stuff's pretty interesting. Like this thing, it looks like a wheat field. It's pretty intense there.
Yeah, Field Reads is by John. And it's a kinetic sculpture that really kind of digs deep into the idea of past experience and kind of story of the Field of Reeds.
And is this various media here that we have?
There's paintings, there's drawings, there's collage, video, and the kinetic piece is made out of wood, plastic, steel, and electric motor.
Okay. Is there anything else, anything you can add, anything you have to say?
I think it's interesting to see the role of an artist as a curator. A studio artist who's really focused on his work, and at the same time, someone who's interested in the discourse that occurs whenever you bring multiple artists together.
Yeah, well, I'm a printmaker, and printmaking involves many traditional techniques. For the most part, the work that's on display involves relief printmaking, which involves carving of a wood block, and silkscreen, which is basically an elaborate stencil, and also hand-drawn elements and monoprinting. I'm mostly influenced by cellular illustrations, biology, roots, the idea of rhizomes, and these organisms that sprout their own roots and sustain life, and growing and undulating forms. And that kind of, in some words, describes what the work is, but each one really is their own habitat and life form within themselves.
Okay. And what are you hoping to, what's your aspirations for this? What are you hoping to do with this?
Where to go from this? That's a really good question. Right now, this has been the first time that I have really consistently made work since I was in undergrad. I went to art school, and it's been about 3 years. And in the course of 2010, I really got back into making artwork in the studio rather than for other people or, you know, other types of project-based work. And so for this was really more of a freedom of expression again, giving myself the independence outside of school and outside of any other sort of obligations, I guess, to make work. So from here, really, it's a jumping off point to more of that.
Okay. All right. Is there anything else you can add? Anything you can talk about?
I don't think so.
Okay. Do you have a website or something?
I actually don't have a website right now, no.
Is there anywhere that people can find your work online?
Online right now, you can go to the Arts Incubator, kc.org, and you can find information about me and my work. And I do have a studio space at the Arts Incubator, which is at 115 East 18th Street here in Kansas City, Missouri.
Definitely a collaborative effort. Myself, Bill Drummond helped out, and Zadi Khalsa, the artist for that painting right there, and some of the other work upstairs. Really, Zadi found the other two artists. So I did the administrative stuff. She did the artsy stuff. Zadi and Brock are portrait artists. Jenny is more abstract. All of her paintings, I read her artist statement. She says they're emotional, not intellectual. It's both a fundraiser for the event and for the campaign, and also a great way to get people in the headquarters, get the mayor's name out, and also the mayor is a fan of the Crossroads. He thinks it represents one of Kansas City's best examples of organic growth in the city, and so kind of to tell, and so he has lots of friends in the Crossroads, and we've been sort of sucked into art because of it, and so we have art in the campaign now. We have lots of artists who are volunteers, and together they came up with this idea, and I thought it was great.
It's a Chinese New Year. Yesterday was the actual Chinese New Year. It's generally a 2 to 3 day celebration, but up to about 15 days. And it's also our 1 year anniversary here.
Okay, and what are you doing to celebrate this?
Well, we have all of the work in the gallery is by three artists, all visual artists, multidisciplinary. And everything is Chinese zodiac based. So there are 12 animals in the zodiac, and there are live music, as you can hear. A little bit later, we'll have some martial arts demonstrations, and a few other surprises. Whether it be in the gallery or the tattoo work, generally we try to focus on meticulous, detailed work. And something that's more thought-provoking than just art for art's sake.
Tonight's show is about art, power, and politics, and the idea of communicating with visual images to discuss current events, cultural events, things that are contemporary. I mean, the world contains so much that's going on right now. You have this situation in Egypt, for instance. You have the fact that we're still embroiled in two wars. People won't say they're wars. The Afghanistan's complicated. It's got NATO. It's involved with all the players, George Bush, all the famous people. So we have icons that are supposed to be interrelated to build a kind of sense of the American dream and our question regarding how well people are achieving it. There's a lot of information embedded in this particular installation. All of the artists' works brought together. It's supposed to represent something. I'm not really sure what it's supposed to mean to each individual. I've been so busy helping set it up that I haven't had a chance to really fully digest it, you know. Some of the pieces arrived very late, so we had to move things around to accommodate. So it's synthesized as well as we know how, in the sense that all of the individual artists' artworks are hung as best we could to achieve a a sense that they're not, they don't disappear in each other. There's a coordination to it that allows each thing to stand out. That's the attempt.
Yeah.
Cameraman.
Well. Oh, really?
One day I saw an upright piano on the school.
Next month is dialogues and narratives, so everything will relate to conversations, dialogue, narratives, stories, things like that. So stay tuned for that next month. Keep it on your calendar. It's the last Thursday of every month. So next month it will be, I think, the 31st. If we're friends on Facebook, you will know, because I will send you invites. So hopefully I'll see everybody back here again, and these will continue each month. I'm just saying this for those of you who have not been here before or are not familiar. The month after that will be Child's Play, so it will be works and performances by other local artists with things that are inspired by our childhood memories, nostalgia, childlike behaviors, and adult childlike behaviors. And then we will conclude the following month in May with a citywide talent show. So if you guys have talent, start thinking about them, because you are welcome to participate. We will have set performers, and it will be open to the public to come and perform and sign up. So thank you again.
gets awful loud and a magical wake-up call.
What do you think of all this?
Crazy. Cool.
Texas this morning?
Oh, not this. Well, actually, last year too. Yeah, yeah, I did. Thanks.
6 miles. Ain't no temple.
I said
1 year.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ain't no time.
Yeah.
We're on a bus. On a bus. Dying Angola.
My front yard in about half an hour.
That's great. That's great. It's always something to do.
Photography work, and then we did a collaboration together.
So we did a video piece together called Over Again, and kind of about this ideas of isolation and anxiety. And it's not just a video piece, we actually created the environment of the kind of the similar surroundings that our character is in. I think, you know, the work talks about anxiety and the idea of you know, dealing with your own isolation and the idea of aging. So relating to the character and putting, you know, themselves in it. And I think a lot of our work kind of relates to the same ideas.
We made it in my studio in Brooklyn, and we did it on weekends. Sarah would come from D.C., and we would shoot in my studio like every other weekend over last summer.
Yeah,
over, probably 6 or 7 months period of time. So now we're having a good time with Steven Tima. I'm showing some work at the Faster Lipstick Gallery here in the West Bottoms at the Hobbs Building. It's a pop-up gallery type event, so it's only one night, so that would be tonight, and then it won't be anymore. Pop-up gallery is, it goes up and it comes down. It's a new concept where people use unused spaces to show work and give people exposure in a limited time frame. So now I'm showing a pretty decent range of my work from older work to some of my newer work that I've been creating. Also, there's a wide range of techniques and mediums that I've shown tonight. There's pieces on plywood, pieces on canvas. There's a sculptural piece in there. There's also a piece on some plexiglass. So I just tried to show a wide range in a brief moment of what I've been able to do in the past couple of years. Support your local artists. You know, hang in there for us, and we'll hang in there for you. But, you know, it's rough out here. It's rough out here.
The artists go marching one by one.
I don't know if we're gonna let let us in with this camera crew. I mean, the camera crew is a dangerous crew. They don't want a gang representing here in Kansas City, a camera gang, especially nothing. I mean, you know, justice comes at the barrel of a camera these days.
Local artists made it for the mayor.
Made it to the 29th floor. No, please don't.
Doing what's good for the people because they don't know who the people are. They have no idea. They're not living on the ground level. That's where Funkhauser was way different.
But you can see it's got a neo-Gothic thing going with those little arches. Most of it's been covered up by that modern facade that is stuck on.
Yeah. But it's...
Don't fall down trying to get the baby birds.
No, sir. Real close.
A baby gargoyle going to sprout out of this building.
Very angry about the mayor losing.
They were stakes or, you know, pointy things just right here, but it was a spike. It's pointy things that attract people.
Mayor
Pro Tem,
Mr. Mayor, I move the charter requirements being ordered to the present occasion to waive the ordinances of the first reading of the Village Camp and to today's docket and these ordinances of the Village Camp. Second. Move and second that the charter requirements for reading the ordinances of the first occasion to waive the ordinances. Any discussion on the motion? Please call the roll.
Turbin.
Aye.
Scott.
Aye.
Ford. Johnson.
Aye.
Burst.
Aye.
Sanders.
Aye.
Blackstein.
Aye.
Markson.
Aye.
Sarkoff.
Aye.
Riley.
Aye.
Joe.
Aye.
Sharp.
Funkhouse. Aye. Motion carries. Does anyone come before the body? Move for adjournment.
And that was all they.
I don't know what to make of it. What's it all mean? It's very interesting. It's kind of compelling. I wish I had the kind of power that guy seems to have. Never quite got there, though.
Maybe next time.
Chalkboard. We've taken a lot of their various writings over the years and just put their words on the walls in chalk. We do have their journals for people to read. We also have a recording, a voiceover recording that they did that they're actually working on a film right now, and so that's the voiceover for the film. And then we have projections of both them working and some of their work that they've created. These kids are not bad kids, they've just made bad choices. So we're trying to kind of bridge that gap and show people that they're actually really good kids. A lot of them have had hard lives, and we're just trying to get them on track, and art is the way to do it for us, so.
America Now in Here is a traveling exhibition. Kansas City is kind of the starting off point. There are a lot of local artists here, and it's important to mention it's not just visual artists. We have poets, and we have musicians as well. It's an art exhibition that talks about America. It's to have a conversation about America, a dialogue. It's asking questions about what America is like and maybe what people want America to be like in the future. Eric Fischel, he's an artist who actually does also have a piece here in the exhibit. And I believe it was him and some other artists that kind of started this whole thing in New York City. Well, if you think about Kansas City, it's in the middle of the country. If you think about the history of Kansas City, it's kind of the crossroads for a lot of people, like the Oregon Trail and all these other trails. People will travel to the west but stop in Kansas City. You can go to the website, so you can even just type into Google America Now and Here, and you're going to get all this information.
Thank you. kind of a cooperative effort of about 30 different entities in downtown, putting together art openings, performances, music events, trying to highlight essentially the arts community in Lawrence and the strength of the artists we have here in a variety of disciplines. We've been going since last August, and each one gets busier, so our plan is to keep it rolling. We have a very different community, but I think the idea of bringing everybody into a central location and bringing energy and financial benefits to downtown are similar to the first Fridays. This has been really exciting for me just as an artist. I meet more and more artists each day that I didn't know lived in Lawrence. So that's kind of the fun part for me.
Thank you. show I'm doing, I went with a church plant that I'm involved in to Joplin, Missouri, where we went down to help with the relief efforts. We actually went 3 days after they had had the event happen on that Sunday, so we went on Wednesday and went with a group, and we did a lot of relief work, and then I just kind of documented a lot of the pictures just because I knew that people needed to see that in Kansas City, that something could happen so devastating so close to home. I tried to focus on was finding the images that I thought were so unique that people could relate to, the stuff with cars, with people's homes, just because they needed to see how real it was, because it was so close to Kansas City and so close to something that could happen here realistically. When these kind of traumatic events happen, it's more important on the back end to come in, you know, months after the fact to help with cleanup. It's more important to do it then than it is at the very beginning. So I just hope that people see this and realize that they can still help. People just always put out a helping hand because you never know if something like this could happen to you, and you'd like to hope that someone would reach out a hand for you.
This was the first one.
Oh, that's the first one. Okay, 2 hours. Then
the first one, and then Tom said, make another one.
Who are your models for this one? Are they photographs also? Are they, you, did you work for photographs also? All right.
Yeah, the girl I know.
Okay.
She's from Texas. She's Mexican, of course. She had the beret on. But I added it. I just painted the star on this.
And you handled the softness of her skin tones.
Yes.
It looks like airbrush.
Well, my idea was that I was going to do all of her skin in airbrush. And then make texture all around.
Is there any pencil in this at all, or is it all painting?
No, it's all painting.
It's all painting.
No. All airbrush and then paint. I really like this one, but you know, I think this one's good too.
Win. When the previous owner decided that she was going to sell the building and close her gallery, I really, yes, felt great motivation to keep this art gallery in Paola, and so I took over it. I purchased the building and basically took over the business that was here. It's local artists. We have artists represented from the Kansas City area, but lots of artists actually from here in Paola. It's very eclectic. We really don't focus on a particular style of art. So we have paintings. The current show features an Overland Park artist named Jeannie Foster. David Gross is a local Paola resident. His paintings are always in the gallery. We also have jewelry, photography, pottery, ceramics. We really do have such talented people in the Paola area that I was amazed when I moved back here that there was this kind of talent, this, you know, this number of talented people with art to show.
My partner, Betts, came back to town from West Virginia to put her daughter through her last couple of years of high school. We thought it'd be kind of neat to have something different and unusual in Garnett. I had some abilities and some resources, and Betts had a lot of resources that I didn't have, and combined we were able to get this far. A lot of our locals appreciate it. Visitors that come to the community like yourself enjoy it because it kind of reminds them of what they have at home. So I think we've completed that part of the mission. We've got a facility here that's wide open, very comfortable. We just felt like that was that we were missing that in Garnett. My company is Symphonic Studios Incorporated. I give private lessons, but it's also padded, so I can give, you know, services to people who are wanting to do recordings or voiceovers. It's baby steps right now. We have a lot of people using the facility for the free Wi-Fi, but at the same time, we have some good food and good coffee.
No idea.
Huh?
Mm-hmm. So this.
Weekly series I do at Rise, the poop collector is called by Bird. It's a grassroots that we do special shows and collaborate with other artists. There's a little more than just jazz, and there's definitely jazz influence when we do other things. It's an open house rehearsal, so it's great. People can come and see what we do. It's more of a contained jam. It's not so much an open jam session. We also have a purpose. You know, a lot of times when we're not rehearsing, we're creating music, we're composing. This is a really good opportunity for people who want to see the kind of behind the scenes what artists do to create, put together a show, the right music. The Thursday night for Live Days is a good opportunity. There's lots of other groups that I've seen doing a lot of great creative things down here, and not just as far as music is concerned. We're here on Thursday nights. We usually start at some point after 9. We usually go pretty late. So if you're ready to come out at 2 a.m., we might be here. So stop by.